Family, we welcome you to our very first Wednesday night service at Restoration Church. We are so blessed that you have joined us tonight. Thank you, Joyce, for leading us to the throne room and some awesome praise and worship. All right, open your Bible to the book of Romans chapter 12. Open your Bible to the book of Romans chapter 12. We are studying the motivational gifts, Romans chapter 12, verses 3 through 8. We see in verse 3 where the Apostle Paul instructs us not to think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think. Or in other words, don't think you're more important than you really are. Verse 4 tells us we are many members, but yet we are all a part of one body, the body of Christ. And all the different members in the body of Christ, we don't have the same office. We don't have the same calling. We don't have the same ministry. We all are unique. Verse 6, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, that's the first motivational gift, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith. Verse 7, our ministry, we studied that one last time, that is serving, or ministry, or practical serving. Let us wait on their ministering, or he that teacheth on teaching, that's the third one. Verse 8, or he that exhorteth on exhortation, and that's the one we're going to be covering tonight. He that exhorteth on exhortation, he that giveth, that's the next gift, let him do it with simplicity. He that ruleth, that's the next gift, ruler or organizer. He that ruleth with diligence, and he that sheweth mercy, that's the seventh gift, with cheerfulness. Remember, in our study so far of the motivational gifts, we have found in Matthew chapter 25, you remember, we studied the parable of the talents, how that every person received a different quantity, a different number of talents. Some received five, some received two, and then there was one that only received one talent. Then from Luke chapter 19, we studied the parable of the pounds. And we learned that when you was born in the natural, when your mother gave birth to you in the natural, you received talents. Some people are multi-talented, aren't they? But and then at your new birth, when you was born again, you received one pound. You received one motivational gift. You received a pound of purpose. And you remember what we talked about, when you study the motivational gifts, three things are going to happen. Number one, you're going to realize, you're going to recognize your place, your calling, your ministry in the body of Christ. Number two, you're going to grow and mature in that place. And number three, you're going to be able to understand other people better, both your brothers and sisters in the body of Christ and your friends and your relatives. And we studied last time the motivational gift of ministry or serving. Our ministry, let us wait on our ministering, Romans 12, 7 says. You remember ministry or server, practical serving. You remember we learned that the server is the hands of the body. The server recognizes practical needs and is quick to meet them. Remember we learned that servers don't like delays. They like to get her done. They want to jump in there and get that project, get that goal finished and then go on to something else. And they enjoy manual projects. They're very gifted with their hands. They can cook, sew, do arts and crafts if they're a lady. Or if they're a man, they're real gifted with their hands. They can do carpenter work, a lot of them. Make great mechanics, real good at working with their hands. And you remember we learned servers like short-range goals. Don't give them a project that's going to take them 6 or 8 months. They get frustrated with that. They want to get things finished quickly. And we learned that they remember details. They remember your likes and your dislikes. They remember what you like to drink. And they'll always have it ready for you when you come to visit. They'll always cook your favorite meal for you when you come. They enjoy showing hospitality. They love it when company comes. They love to entertain people. You remember we studied about the widow woman who served the prophet Elisha. She built him a room. She got him a candlestick and a bed. She took care of him. She fed him and she met his practical needs. Anytime he came through her town, she wanted him to stay at her house and built him a room just for him, his own personal hotel room anytime he was in her town. Don't you know he loved being waited on and cared for by this woman? And what did the scripture call her? A great woman. And we learned if you have the motivational gift of serving, the scripture calls you a great woman. And if you're a man and have the motivational gift of serving, you are a great man in God's eyes. And you remember we learned that servers have a hard time saying no. They just want to help everybody and it's hard for them to say no. And they need to feel appreciated and they're so sensitive if they feel that what they are doing for you is not genuinely appreciated by you. We studied about Martha, Dorcas, the widow woman who served Elisha, and Ruth. So we studied four different Bible characters with the motivational gift of serving. And that's one thing you will learn as we find out what the characteristics of each of these motivational gifts are. Anytime you read your Bible and read a story about a Bible character, you will be able to determine what that character's motivational gift is, and it will make the scripture come alive so much more. It'll make the scripture so much more clear to you. I want you to get hooked on the book. I want you to fall in love with the Word of God. And One way is by reading it with new eyes. And once we go through the study of the motivational gifts, you're going to read your Bible with fresh eyes. You'll see things that you've never saw before as you read about the different Bible characters in the Word of God. Now tonight we're going to cover the motivational gift of exhortation. Exhortation, there in Romans chapter 12 verse 8. He that exhorteth on exhortation. That word exhortation in the Greek, if you look it up in the Strong's Concordance, it means to call near. To call near, to call to one side or comfort. It has the idea of taking someone's arm and helping them and leading them through. It's as if they grab you by the arm and say, come on, I'll help you. I'll show you what to do. I'll go with you. Come on with me. I'll take care of you. Exhorters are people. Exhorters love people. And those that have the motivational gift of exhortation, they are usually very popular and have a lot of friends. Whereas we go through the motivational gifts, some of the other motivational gifts, they're loners, like the prophecy motivational gift. They have very few friends. They'd rather be by themselves, but not an exhorter. They want to be surrounded by people. They love people. The word exhorteth in the Greek, that Greek word is parakleo. Parakleo is the Greek word for exhorteth. Now, exhorters are the mouth of the body. And we learned last time that servers are the hands of the body. They take care of practical needs of people. And they clean the church. And they get everything in order. They are the hands of the body. But the exhorters are the mouth of the body. They get very, very excited about the scriptures. They're very excited people. And they, if it's an exhorter that is a minister, either a preacher or a teacher, they preach or teach with excitement. And if you like them, you love them. But if you don't like them, you just don't like them, period. There's no in between with exhorters. You either love them or you don't care for them if they are ministers and upbringing the word. Now, remember what our one word was last time on serving? To get you to remember about the motivational gift of serving? You remember it's nachos. Serving is not my gift. And if the motivational gift of serving is not yours, then it's nachos' gift either. Well, our one word for exhorter is comfortable. Everybody say comfortable.
Comfortable.
And you say, why is the word comfortable the word to remember and help me remember this motivational gift of exhortation? I'm glad you asked. I want to read you something really quickly, and then as we go through this gift, you'll understand about the word comfortable that will help you to remember the motivational gift of exhortation. This is entitled The Bull. Two sisters, one blonde and one brunette, inherit the family ranch. Unfortunately, after just a few years, they are in financial trouble. In order to keep the bank from repossessing the ranch, they need to purchase a bull so they can breed their own stock. The brunette tells her sister, that's blonde, there's a bull for sale at this farm. When I get there, if I decide to buy the bull, I'll contact you to drive out after me and haul it home. The brunette arrives at the man's ranch, inspects the bull, she decides she wants to buy it. The man tells her that he will sell it for $599 and no less. After paying him, she drives to the nearest town to send her sister a telegram to tell her the news. This was way back before cell phones. She walks into the telegraph office and says, I want to send a telegram to my sister telling her that I bought a bull for our ranch. I need her to hitch the trailer to our pickup truck and drive out here so we can haul it home. The telegraph operator explains that he'll be glad to help her. Then he adds, it's just 99 cents a word. Well, after paying for the bull, she only has $1 left. She had $600. She paid $599 for the bull. She only has $1 left. She realizes she'll only be able to send her sister one word. After thinking for a few minutes, she nods and says, I want to send her the word comfortable. The telegraph operator shakes his head and says, how is she ever going to know that you want her to hitch the trailer to your pickup truck and drive out here to haul that bull back to your ranch? How's she going to know that if you send her the word comfortable? The brunette explains, my sister's blonde. The word is big. She'll read it slow. Comfortable. Come for the bull. Our word to remember for the motivational gift of exhortation is comfortable. Everybody say comfortable.
Comfortable.
All right. Now let's go through the characteristics, the qualities of those that have the motivational gift of exhortation. Number one, an exhorter would rather present the truth in teaching than study and research and prepare in order to teach. That's right the opposite of someone who has the teaching motivational gift. The teacher would rather research and study than get up and present it, but not the exhorter. The exhorter wants to just jump up and tell you about it without having to study, without having to research. They don't like to look up words in the Greek or Hebrew. They don't like sermon preparation. They just want to get up and talk. Number two, exhorters draw people. They love to work with people, and they are the real fatherly type. They hate to be by themselves. They love to be around other people. We're going to look at the scriptural example of a man named Barnabas in the New Testament. Barnabas is a wonderful example of someone with the motivational gift of exhortation. probably the most well-known minister in our lifetime with the motivational gift of exhortation was Kenneth Hagin. He just went home to be with the Lord just a few years ago. He was a classic exhorter. He would start out, he may say, all right, I'm going to teach on faith. And about two or three sentences in, he'll say, I remember back in 1957, did you know that was on a Thursday night? And he'll tell you every detail about this story, and he may or may not ever get back to faith. And you're thinking, what does this have to do with the subject at hand? That is a classic exhorter. Number three, the third characteristic, exhorters preach abundant living. They encourage others to live victoriously. Oh, and they want to help others to fulfill their potential in their life. Number four, exhorters apply the word to daily life. They focus on practical application. They will preach sermons and teach if they're called to teach, and that will show you how to apply Christian principles to your daily life. Whereas a teacher will just give you Bible facts often and just go down the script, go down a chapter verse by verse. But an exhorter, they want to tell you how to apply a principle to your daily life. So see, don't we need every type of minister to teach us and to help us to grow and mature in the body of Christ? You would be bored out of your mind if you had to listen to me every service. We need variety. We need different gifts to minister to us, to teach us, because my way of teaching may not be able to learn that much from me, whereas someone with an exhortation motivational gift, you may just love to hear them tell personal stories rather than going verse by verse down a chapter out of the Bible. The fifth characteristic, exhorters tell stories about personal experiences, and then they will try to find a scripture to go along with what they're telling you about. Whereas a teacher brings out examples from the Bible, and they tell very few personal experiences. But exhorters, their philosophy is truth is truth, whether it comes from the Bible or whether it comes from my experience. Whereas a teacher has got to come right from the Word. The teacher says Word first, then you can tell about an experience only if it applies to the scripture that you're covering or the subject that you're covering. But an exhorter is right the opposite. They say, experience first, let me tell you what happened to me, and then they'll just try to hunt up a scripture to go along with it. The sixth characteristic, exhorters side in with the underdogs. They are always root for somebody that's down, somebody that's discouraged. And an exhorter will take that person under their wing, and they'll help them, and they'll pet them, and they'll encourage them. Whereas a teacher will say, now I told you what to do. And in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15, remember I told you. But no, not an exhorter. An exhorter will take them by the arm and pull them up and say, come on and go with, I'll help you. And they wrap their arms around you and they encourage you. Whereas a teacher is just going to say, well, the Word says you need to do this and this and this. Now, exhorters, they love people and they want to encourage them. And we're going to read about the exhorter Barnabas. The disciples rejected Paul when Paul was first born again. But Barnabas went to Paul and he said, come on, Paul, I'll introduce you to the apostles. The disciples may be afraid of you because you've been persecuting the Christians, putting them in prison, having them killed. They may not want to have anything to do with you, but come on, go with me. I'll introduce you to the apostles. And we're going to read about where Paul was getting ready to go on his second missionary journey. Barnabas was going with him, and Barnabas wanted to take John Mark, the young minister, with him. And Paul said, nope, not going to take him this time. He got homesick on our first missionary journey. Mm-hmm. He turned back. He went home to mama, and we're not going to take him again. So Barnabas said, come on, John Mark. I'll help you. Let's go this way. And they took off. An exhorter takes people in and says, come on, I'll help you. Don't get discouraged. Don't quit the ministry. Don't stop going to church. Come on back to church. I know Sister Doodad may have hurt your feelings, but she really didn't mean it. Come on back to church. An exhorter will take you by the arm and say, come on, I'll help you. They encourage you. Remember, they're very fatherly, really paternal. They want to They're the mother hen. They want to just watch over you and just smother you with affection. We're going to talk about the prophet Elisha. We're going to look at Elisha. He is a great example of someone with a motivational gift of exhortation. The prophet Elisha, he went and he lived with the people, lived right in the village with the people. Whereas the prophet Elijah, he was a loner. He lived in the mountains, in the caves. He didn't want anybody around. He will study about him when we get to the motivational gift of prophecy. So you see, ministers don't have the same motivational gift, just like the person sitting next to you may not have the same motivational gift that you do. But we're all important. We're all needed. We're all different members in the one body of Christ. And when we talk about the prophet Elisha, we're going to see how he loved the people. An exhorter loves people. And Elisha always lived among the people, and he said, come on, I'll help you, I'll teach you. Whereas Elijah, on the other hand, just said, repent. You're in sin, and you need to repent. So, completely different personalities, but yet they were both prophets, but they had different motivational gifts. The seventh characteristic of someone with a motivational gift of exhortation. They encourage others to develop and grow in their personal ministries. They have the gift of encouragement. It just comes natural to them. They love to encourage others. When I had my Bible study, my Bible study for 7 years and 3 months, and I was blessed to have a couple of wonderful people who had the motivational gift of exhortation. And there would be times when I would think, oh, I just didn't do well tonight. I blew it. I just didn't present the word good. But one man would always come up and hug me, and he said, I enjoyed that. That was so good. He was an encourager. He encouraged me so much. But I want you to keep him in mind, because we're going to talk a little bit more about him later on. An exhorter loves to see people using the gift and using the ministry that God has given them. And they get excited when they see people mature and grow in the Lord. Number eight, exhorters are into plans of action. They want those plans carried out because they can see the end results, which is growth, maturity in that person. They love to give instructions that will help others with a problem that they're facing in their life. Someone with the motivational gift of exhortation gets excited when they see that person that they're helping, when they see them mature and begin to grow and develop in the Lord. Number nine, exhorters love to do personal counseling because they are concerned and interested in helping people with their problems. They love personal counseling. Number 10, but an exhorter will stop counseling if a person that they are counseling are not following their steps of action and not making an effort to change and to start to grow and mature in the Lord. Number 11, exhorters are fluent in communication. Since exhorters are the mouth of the body, they just naturally have a way with words. You can say they have the gift of gab, so much so that they never stop talking. They go on and 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 on some more. And you're trying to get away from them. If they call you on the phone an hour later, you're still trying to get off the phone with them, and they still are talking. Remember, what's their word?
Comfortable.
Keep it short and sweet, but an exhorter can't do that. They may start out telling you about one subject and then get totally off the subject, and you're thinking, what in the world does this have to do with what they called me about on the phone? And an hour later, they're still talking about different things and never have told you the real purpose of why they called. And for me, I'm about to scream by that time. But exhorters, they just have a gift of gab. They open their mouth and it never closes. What's their word? Comfortable. Keep it short and sweet. Comfortable. Don't say, now I need you to hook the trailer to the pickup truck, drive to this town, and we're going to get the bull. No, comfortable. Keep it short and sweet. But exhorters can't do that because they have a gift of gab. Number 12, exhorters need to see a visual response when they're preaching or when they're teaching. They need to know that you're with them, that you're paying attention, and that you're all ears and attentive to what they're saying. They need your undivided attention, and they get upset if they feel that you are not paying attention to what they're saying. They watch the expressions on faces, and they watch reactions of people. Whereas me, when I'm up teaching, I try to tune it out, because the enemy will try to get you to zero in on somebody that's yawning or somebody that's nodding off. And then the enemy said, you are boring. You have no anointing. Why don't you just shut up and sit down? Nobody was interested in hearing what you're saying. An exhorter, where I tune it out and look at someone else, an exhorter will just tune in and just hone in on that person and watch their expressions and their reactions, because they need to know that you're with them. Exhorters, they preach and they teach excited messages, and they get upset if the people don't get excited right along with them. Exhorters are always concerned about what other people think, and if someone quits coming to church, they'll think, oh no, they must be upset with me. Oh no, they must not like me anymore. And they get so upset and they think, oh, I love you, but why don't you like me anymore? That is a characteristic of an exhorter. They need the support and the encouragement of the people. Now let's look at the faults or problem areas that those with the motivational gift have to pay attention and have to be careful about. Now, the first fault, the first problem area, if you have the motivational gift of exhortation, you really have to watch this if you are a minister. Number one, the exhorters use scripture for practical application, and it appears that they're taking the scripture out of context. They tend to pick out a portion of a passage and present it instead of using the whole message, the whole chapter, or the whole thought. Whereas a teacher, I'll read the chapter before. I may start at the beginning of the book and read all the way up to the chapter I'm going to teach on. I may read the rest of the book following the chapter. I want to make sure that I don't take anything out of context. I want to present the whole truth. But an exhorter, they'll have a personal story they want to tell you, listen, what happened to me? And they'll find a verse or two or three lines out of a verse and to go along with that message and that personal experience. So taking the scriptures out of context is a real problem area for those in the ministry who have the motivational gift of exhortation. Number two, exhorters interrupt others because they just have to give their opinion. It seems that they aren't even listening to what you're saying because they're just waiting for you to pause so they can start talking. If you're around an exhorter, they are just watching your mouth. They are watching for you to pause and take a breath. And then, oh, you've lost it, because they're going to jump in and they're going to take over the conversation and they're going to talk. And you're not going to be able to get in a word edgewise, because they got the floor and they're not about to give it up. And whether it's got a thing in the world to do with the subject that you're talking about or not, they just want to talk.
Yeah.
The third fault or problem area, when giving others steps of action, when they're counseling someone, they are often cut and dried. They say, do this, and do this, and your problem will be solved. Mission accomplished. When they haven't taken time to pray and ask the Holy Spirit what to say to that person, what is the words of counsel that that person needs to hear? Just because do this, this, and this was what the person you counseled before needed to hear, that may be totally opposite of what this person needs to hear. So, exhorters, if you are counseling people, you must learn to stop talking, zip your lip, and listen to the Holy Spirit for the Holy Spirit's direction to lead you and guide you in what to say to counsel and encourage other people. Number four, because exhorters are so outspoken and talk so much, it's often hard for them to stop talking and just be quiet. Isn't that the truth? How many of you know an exhorter? What's that word? Comfortable. We want you to get to the point instead of rambling on and on and on and on about irrelevant details about something that doesn't amount to a hill of beans, that has nothing to do with the subject or nothing to do with your problem or the question that you ask them. Stop talking so much, exhorters. Comfortable is your word.
Comfortable.
Yes. Narrow it down. Condense it. Number five, exhorters often become overly self-confident because they have the ability to give advice. They'll often give advice that is wrong for someone. And they can even interfere with God's dealing in that person's life because they just say, do this, 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 and problem will be solved. When the Lord may be wanting to lead that person in the total opposite direction and do the total opposite thing. So exhorters, you've got to be sensitive to not interfere with the leading of the Holy Spirit in the person's life that you are counseling and talking with. Number six, exhorters often seem to oversimplify your problem. They're so busy patting you on the back, taking you by the arm and telling you everything's going to be all right. They don't even seem to be concerned about your problem because they're just too busy encouraging you. Oh, don't get upset. Don't be upset. Everything's going to be all right. Just do what I tell you and you're going to be fine. And it seems like that they aren't sensitive to your problem. And how many of you have problems that just a little one or two word answer is not going to fix it? Only intense prayer and time will be the answer for some problems. But exhorters, they lose sight of that. They think everything is a quick fix, and they want to tell you how to get that problem area fixed in your life and move on to something else. And one other fault or problem area that I want to add to your list, that I don't have it, but I have saw this over and over and over. Out of 34 and a half years of ministry and dealing with people with the motivational gift of exhortation, I have saw this. Number seven, when an exhorter gets on the negative side of their gift, they go on and on and on. And the more they talk, the more stern they can become. If they are upset with you, especially if it's your spouse or your son, your daughter, family member, friend, if they want to prove a point or if they're upset, the more they talk, the louder they get and the more stern they get and the more of a rebuke it becomes, instead of speaking in love and not going on and on and on for an hour, it can turn into scathing rebukes. If you're not careful, you can give that person a tongue lashing and really hurt them with your words. And many Christians even stop going to church because they have become so hurt by being, just attacked almost verbally by someone with the motivational gift of exhortation that tells them, no, you need to do what I am telling you to do. And that may not be what the Lord is leading them to do. And especially if it's a married couple and the married couple is having an argument or a heated discussion, and the exhorter will say, you remember what you did back in 1952. You did this, you did this, and you said this, and you said this. And they'll bring up every detail of everything that you have done wrong from the day you got married. And you don't need to hear that, do you, other spouse that doesn't have the motivational gift of exhortation? You don't need to hear 2 hours worth of tongue lashing. You need to get that disagreement resolved and get back in love. Instead of the more that person with the motivational gift of exhortation talks, the more angry they become. Have you ever saw people just get red-faced and just lose it and start yelling and screaming? You remember the man that I told you in my Bible study that had the motivational gift of exhortation would always come up and encourage me? Well, one night at Bible study, I said something that did not agree with his Baptist theology. And he did manage to wait until Bible study end. But I tell you, I've never gotten a tongue lashing like I've got by that man ever before. He was red-faced. The veins in his neck was popped out. He was flailing his arms around. And the longer he talked it, the lower everybody sunk in their seats. And I didn't want to hurt his feelings. And I dismissed the Bible study. And I said, you are dismissed for tonight. He kept on and on just like I hadn't said a word. He was on a roll. He was on a roll giving me a tongue lashing. And exhorters will actually forget how they are acting because they want to prove their point so bad. They want to prove they're right and you're wrong. And it can just turn a lot of Christians off. And it has. And a lot of people have been hurt and stopped going to church altogether. So exhorters, if you have this gift, you can be a wonderful help and asset to the body if you stay in your good qualities and don't be more developed in the bad qualities, in the faults. And that's why we'll cover the good qualities and the problem areas of each of the gifts. And yes, we all have problem areas, don't we? Nobody's perfect. Now let's go to the Word of God and let's look at some biblical examples quickly of people with the motivational gift of exhortation. We're going to look at the prophet Elisha first in 2 Kings chapter 6 verses 1 through 7. We're going to see an example of the prophet Elisha living with the people. The people came to Elisha and he said, hey, the place where we're living is just too small. We're too cramped. Let's move to a bigger area. Let's clear off the land. Let's build houses. Will you go with us? The last part of verse 2 says, go ye. And then one of them said, oh, be content, I pray you, to go with thy servants. And he answered, I will go. At first, Elisha said, well, if where you're living is too cramped, if there's not enough room in this area, then you just move and you build houses and you go with my blessings. And somebody said, no, Elisha, go with us. Won't you move with us? And he said, yep, I'll go with you. Verse 4, he went with them. When they came to the Jordan River, they started cutting wood to build their homes. And as one was cutting down a beam of timber, what happened? You've read this story a dozen times. The axe head broke and it fell into the water. And he comes running to the prophet Elijah and he said, alas, or oh good grief, master. It was borrowed. It was very valuable. And so the prophet Elisha, what did he do? Verse 6, the man of God said, where fell it? Where did it fall? And he's shooting the place. He said, it went in the water right over here, Elisha. And Elisha cut down a stick, threw it in that water, and what happened to that metal axe head? It floated from the bottom of that riverbed up to the surface. And the prophet Elisha said, take it up. And he put out his hand and he took it up. Now that in the natural is impossible, isn't it? For a stick of wood to cause a metal heavy object to float upward. But it did. That wooden stick, we talked about it before, was so filled with the power and the anointing because the prophet of God had touched it. You remember I did a whole teaching on the anointing is transferable. The anointing was transferred from the prophet Elisha into that wooden stick. And when he threw it into the water, that metal axe head was just drawn to the anointing that was in that wooden stick. You need to read the miracles that the prophet Elisha performed. They're just amazing. You remember the story that the prophet Elisha had been dead for years. And a group of men was going by his sepulcher and they threw a dead man in on the prophet's bones. And what happened when that dead man hit the prophet Elisha's bones, there was still so much of the power and the anointing in his bones, that dead man came back to life instantly. That goes to show you the prophet Elisha got a double portion of the prophet Elijah's anointing. Elijah transferred, he passed on his anointing to the prophet Elisha. Elisha did not pass on that double portion. He died with that anointing in him. That's why that anointing was in his bones. He didn't pass it on. That's why it's so important for ministers to pass on the anointing. Don't die with that anointing in you. You pass it on. You train others. You teach others. And impart what you know and what you have into others. The prophet Elisha is a great example of someone with the motivational gift of exhortation. He loved the people and he lived among the people. Now, in Luke chapter 2, I told you if we had time, we wanted to look real quickly. Anna, the prophetess. Yes, there were women in the Bible who were prophetesses, and Anna was a prophetess. And we see in Luke chapter 2, verses 25 through 26, it tells us that Simeon, he was a righteous man, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. The Holy Spirit didn't infill him. Why? Because Jesus hadn't died. He hadn't sent the Holy Spirit to indwell man. So the Holy Spirit was upon Simeon. And in verse 26, it tells us that the Holy Spirit revealed to Simeon that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Christ, or before he had saw Jesus, the Savior of the world. And in verse 27, it tells us that the Holy Spirit spoke to Simeon to go into the temple at the exact time that Mary and Joseph was bringing baby Jesus into the temple. Verse 28, Simeon took baby Jesus into his arms. He praised God. And what did he say in verse 29? He said, Lord, let me die, because I have seen the Lord's Christ. I've seen your Savior. All right, I'm ready to die. But he began to prophesy, verses 31 through 35, to Mary and Joseph concerning baby Jesus. But notice verse 36. Anna the prophetess, she was very old, verse 37. She lived in the temple. She served God day and night in the temple through prayer and fasting. Verse 38, she came in. She saw baby Jesus. And did she say like Simeon, all right, I've seen the Messiah. I'm ready to die. Let me die now. No, she told everybody she saw, hey, you don't have to look for the Messiah any longer. He's here. He's been born. The Messiah has been born in Bethlehem. Simeon didn't want to tell anybody. He just wanted to die because the promise of the Lord had been fulfilled. God had promised him that he wouldn't die until he saw the Messiah, the Savior of the world. So he saw Jesus and he said, okay, I don't want to tell anybody that he's here. I just want to die now. But not Anna the prophetess. She wanted to tell everybody she saw, hey, the Messiah is here. And that's what an exhorter does. They want to tell everybody they see about the good news, about the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. They want everybody to know about Jesus. Hallelujah. And the motivational gift of exhortation is such a wonderful gift in the body of Christ. Now let's talk about Barnabas quickly. In the book of Acts, chapter 4, Acts chapter 4, verses 36 through 37. Joseph, who by the apostles was surnamed Barnabas, which is being interpreted the son of consolation, or the son of encouragement, or the son of exhortation, describes Barnabas to a T. He was an encourager. He was an exhorter. And he's, what does this scripture tells us? Tell us, he, verse 37, he sold his land, he brought the money, he laid it at the apostles' feet. Now let's look at the word that tells us exactly and gives us a wonderful example of Barnabas as an exhorter. In the book of Acts chapter 9, the people in Damascus, they was trying to kill Paul. They was guarding the gates of the city, and so Paul escaped by being lowered over the city wall in a basket. He had to run for his life because the people wanted to kill him. Verse 26. And when Saul, or Paul, was come to Jerusalem, he essayed, or he wanted to join himself to the disciples, but they were all afraid of him and believed not that he was a disciple. I'm sure Paul was very discouraged. He had just left a city where they were trying to kill him, and he needed the disciples to encourage him and edify him and to teach him, because he had just been born again. He had just had the Damascus Road experience of being knocked off of his high horse, I call it. He thought he was really something, really important. But no, he learned that he wasn't. So after he spent some time being blind, and after Jesus appeared to him there on the road, he needed encouragement. After he began to preach the gospel, all the Christians were afraid of him because he had been persecuted them, having them thrown in prison, having them killed. So the disciples, they didn't want anything to do with this man named Paul. So I'm sure that Paul was very discouraged. He needed to be edified, encouraged, built up. But the disciples rejected him, turned him away. Verse 27. We see Barnabas standing in the ministry gift of exhorter. Verse 27, but Barnabas took Paul, brought him to the apostles, and declared unto them how he had seen the Lord in the way, and that he had spoken to him, and that he had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus. You see, Barnabas said, sure, now Paul, he used to persecute Christians, but now he's one of us. Paul was the underdog, and Barnabas was rooting for Paul. He was encouraging Paul. An exhorter pulls for the underdog, and they say, come on, I'll help you. I'll encourage you. Come on, Paul, let's go this way. Verse 27, it says that Barnabas took Paul. That word took, if you look it up in the Greek, it means to seize or to catch or to take hold of. Barney just grabbed Paul by the arm and said, come on, Paul, they may have rejected you, but come on with me, I'll take you to the apostles. They won't reject you. Now, in Acts chapter 15, verses 36 through 41, and it says, and some days after Paul said unto Barnabas, let's go again and visit our brethren in every city where we have preached the word of the Lord and see how they do. And Barnabas determined to take with them John, whose surname was Mark. But Paul thought not good to take him with them, who departed from them from Pamphylia and went not with them to the work. Now notice, Paul's very analytical. He had the motivational gift of teaching. Paul, he analyzed the situation. He said, now on our first missionary journey, John Mark got homesick. He wanted to go home to mommy. He deserted us. He didn't go with us to complete our first missionary journey, so we are not going to take him with us this time. Nope, not going to do it. So what did old Barney do? Barnabas and Paul got into an argument. Remember, exhortation, talks, on and on. I can just picture old Barney and Paul's face going on and on about, we're going to take John Mark. Yes, we are. Paul said, no, we're not. Yes, we are. We need to take him now. And so verse 39, and the contention was so sharp between them. In other words, they had a knockdown, drag-out argument. They got so mad at each other. They departed asunder from one another. In other words, they went separate ways. And so Barnabas took Mark and sailed to Cyprus, and Paul chose Silas and departed, being recommended by the brethren unto the grace of God. And he went through, and it tells you where the area he went, encouraging the churches that he had established on his first missionary journey. So we see Barnabas is a classic exhorter. Barnabas siding in with the underdog. John Mark, don't you know he was discouraged with Paul said, we're not taking him. He's still wet behind the ears. He's just a kid. He's not mature. He got homesick. He's a mama's boy. We're not taking him. So Barnabas said, come on, John Mark, let's go this way. And he took him and with him, and they went the opposite direction because this exhorter had got in Paul's face and said, no, we're going to take him. And Paul said, mm-mm, he's staying here. So Barney took John Mark and he encouraged him. He exhorted him to stay in the ministry, to continue preaching the gospel. Barnabas helped John Mark to grow and mature in the Lord. How do we know that? When you read the gospel of Mark, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Mark was not one of the original 12 disciples. This is John Mark. This is the little kid of a preacher that got discouraged, quit on the first missionary journey. He wrote the gospel of Mark that you have in your Bible. We have this gospel in our Bible because Barnabas encouraged John Mark to go on with God and not quit the ministry. When Paul said, no, he's not going on our second missionary journey. We're not taking him. Forget it. No. Barney said, oh, yeah, we're going. Come on, John Mark. Let's go this way. Don't be discouraged. That old Paul, he's mean. He don't know what he's talking about. Come on, you'll be a good preacher. I'll help you. I'll encourage you. And we have the gospel of Mark in our Bible today because of Barnabas. And we know that Paul had a change of heart because Paul said, hey, in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 11, Paul said, only Luke is with me. Paul said, the only one with me is Luke. You take Mark and bring him with thee, for he is profitable to me for the ministry. Oh, Paul had a change of heart. Imagine that. Barnabas had taught John Mark. He had encouraged him to stay in the ministry and to grow and mature in the Lord. And we have the gospel of Mark in our Bible because Barnabas took John Mark under his wing and helped him. If there hadn't have been a Barnabas, we might not have the gospel of Mark in our Bible. And Paul wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. And we might not have had all those epistles, all those letters in our New Testament if Barnabas hadn't took Paul under his wing when all of the disciples was afraid of him. Barnabas took Paul in and encouraged him and helped him and taught him. So we have 2/3 of the New Testament and the Gospel of Mark in our Bibles because of who? Barnabas. Barnabas, he didn't write anything. But think about it. Paul wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. And John Mark wrote the Gospel of Mark. And Barnabas, didn't write anything. So you see, the motivational gift of exhortation is so important in the body of Christ. The exhorters say, don't give up. Be encouraged. Stay in the ministry. Grow and mature. Don't stop coming to church. Don't quit. walking with the Lord. Read your Bible. Come on back to church. It doesn't matter if Sister Doodad or Sister Long Tongue or Sister Bucket Mouth hurt your feelings. Come on back to church.
Amen.
Don't quit going to church. You be encouraged. Come on, I'll help you. What an awesome gift the motivational gift of exhortation is to the body of Christ. We need this gift of exhortation. Everybody gets discouraged. Everybody wants to quit the ministry. Everybody wants to quit going to church, and a lot of people do. That's where the body of Christ needs exhorters to take them by the arm and say, come on, I'll help you. Don't quit. Don't get disturbed. Don't get discouraged. Don't give up. Stay in the ministry. Exhorters, you are needed in the body of Christ. And one last time, what's their word to remember?
Comfortable.
Exhorters, that's your word. Comfortable. And the body of Christ needs you. Facebook family, we are so blessed that you joined us this evening. You have a blessed night. And if you don't have a regular church to attend, we invite you to attend Restoration Church. You have a blessed night, a blessed week, and we hope to see you in God's house, either here or somewhere in God's house. And if you're an encourager, you keep encouraging others in the Lord. Amen. And everybody say,